Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Your Life Isn't For You, A Selfish Person's Guide to Being Selfless, by Seth Adam Smith. Read to you by the author. Disclaimer: Your life isn't for you. Really, it's not. Your life isn't for you, and my life isn't for me. The truth is that nature didn't design us to find fulfillment in living for ourselves. We can achieve the fullest measure of life only by living it for others. Sucks, doesn't it? Well, I think it does. But maybe that's because I'm not what you would call a people person. To be perfectly honest, people annoy me. I would much rather work alone in my garden than spend an hour or two socializing. So, in a twist of irony, the philosophy I'm about to describe to you, this idea of living your life for others, is one that goes against the flow of my personality. If I would have it my way, I never would have recorded this audiobook. In fact, I'd probably be living in a cabin in the middle of the Alaskan wilderness with a pack of domesticated wolves trained to keep the humans away. But I have learned, through sad and brutal experience, the dangers of taking my preference for solitude to extremes. Instead of my introversion being a healthy need for boundaries and personal reflection, it became an obsessive demand for control and isolation. I began to selfishly live my life purely for myself, and it nearly cost me everything. It was only after I nearly succeeded in taking my life through an attempted suicide that I stumbled across this life-giving philosophy about selflessness. Now, I need to pause here and define what being selfless means, because it's probably conjuring up images of building orphanages, donating your money and possessions to charity, and performing humanitarian efforts under extreme conditions. But that's not what being selfless really means. Not exactly, anyway. While those things can certainly be selfless actions, they are just that, actions. Actions and behaviors can be mimicked or faked for selfish purposes. A person can travel to another country and do humanitarian work for a photo op or publicity, while others can perform life-saving services for money, connections, or other ulterior motives. Honest selflessness is much deeper than our actions. It's a condition of our heart. Being selfless is about opening yourself up to others and learning how to receive life from them and give life back to them. True selflessness is perhaps one of the most paradoxical things in nature. You don't lose yourself for being selfless, you find yourself. You don't lose everything for being selfless, you gain everything. Your life doesn't diminish as you live it for others, it expands. In short, to give life is to truly live life. This book offers a philosophy of how that can be done. Introduction. 2 million views. I stared at my smartphone in shock. My article, Marriage Isn't For You, was going viral. It was November 3rd, 2013. I had been visiting my family in Utah for Halloween and was on a flight back to my home in Florida. My transfer flight had just landed in Baltimore. As soon as the flight attendant gave the okay, I turned on my phone and immediately saw that my blog had received nearly 2.2 million views in 36 hours. Every time I refreshed the screen, the stats had gone up not by hundreds, but by thousands, tens of thousands. In 3 days, the article received a staggering 24 million views. It was reprinted in the Huffington Post and was prominently featured and discussed on the Today Show, BuzzFeed.com, Daily Mail, Cosmopolitan, MSN Living, Yahoo, Deseret News, Today.com, KSL News, TheBlaze.com, HuffPost Live, Headline News, and numerous radio programs. On top of that, Kim, my wife, joined me for national television interviews with Fox and Friends, and Good Morning America. The article has been translated, by volunteers, into more than 20 languages and has gone viral, 100,000 views, in the German, Slovak, Czech, Portuguese, and Spanish languages. As of the spring of 2014, with all of the reprints and translations, Marriage Isn't For You has had well over 30 million hits. But why? What was it about the message that transcended cultural differences and resonated with millions of people around the world? Why did my article go viral? Well, first of all, it wasn't really my article that went viral because it wasn't really my message. It was my dad's. It was counsel given to me in a moment of indecision, at a time when I was debating whether or not I should marry Kim. Was she the right person to marry? Would she make me happy? My father answered these questions with the advice that has gone viral. Seth, you're being totally selfish. So I'm going to make this really simple. Marriage isn't for you. You don't marry to make yourself happy, you marry to make someone else happy. It's not about you. Marriage is about the person you married. His counsel was life-changing. It went completely against the grain of my selfish fears. Perhaps that's why his advice resonated with so many people. Because I think we all recognize, on some level, that selflessly loving others is the right thing to do. Yes, my dad's advice saved me from selfishness, but it wasn't the first time that he had done so. 5 years earlier, my dad had pulled me from a car and dialed 911. When the ambulance arrived at my house, the EMTs immediately began the process of emptying my stomach. I had swallowed a full bottle of sleeping pills and half a bottle of painkillers. I had just tried to end my life. Before that day, I had been living a life of abject selfishness. I thought only about myself, my wants, my feelings, and my problems. My selfishness was a downward spiral that led to a veritable prison of isolation and despair. Unable to find my way out of the darkness and depression, I decided to end the pain and kill myself. When I woke up in the hospital the next morning, I was surrounded by my family members. Brokenhearted as they were, and unsure and untrained in how to respond, they nevertheless rallied to support me as best they could. I had become so self-absorbed that I had walled myself off to everyone and eventually tried to take my life. But standing outside those walls of my selfishness were people willing to give their time, energy, and lives to preserve mine. Although it was incomprehensible to me at the time, my life somehow meant something to other people. My life wasn't for me, it belonged to other people as well. If I was to truly recover from trying to take my life, I needed to learn how to give my life away. But how? How do selfish people like me move from selfishness to selflessness? For one thing, it's not an event, it's a journey. And while I'm certainly not the shining example of selflessness, my experiences have brought me in contact with the lives and literature of those who are. Their examples have been like the northern lights of my life. They have lit my path and guided me forward. So even though I will share many of my own personal experiences, this book really isn't about me. It's about the people, literature, and events that have taught me this life-giving philosophy. But before I get into that, I feel compelled to address a few things. First, in this book, I will talk about serious matters such as depression and suicide. What I share from experience and not from professional training. If you or someone you know is suffering from depression or suicidal thoughts, this book and the principles it espouses are not intended to be used as substitutes for professional medical help. Many of the things I share in this book are things I learned while I was receiving proper medical attention. If you are struggling with depression or suicidal thoughts, I strongly urge you to reach out to trusted friends and seek professional help. Second, it must be understood that I'm a very selfish person, which is probably why my editors chose the subtitle that they did. Footnote 1. After reviewing this line, my editor Neil confirmed it by saying, "Guilty." But remember, it was not my advice, but my father's advice that went viral. In like manner, it is not my actions that are exemplary, but the actions of others. It is through them that I have learned these principles, and it is my experiences with them that I will share with you. Finally, not only am I a very selfish person, but I'm also a very sarcastic person. And although I fully believe in this philosophy that I'm about to share with you, it doesn't change the fact that it sometimes sounds a little too peace, love, hippie, happy, even for me. So my publisher has graciously agreed to give me space to add my occasional commentary. All right, I think that's everything. Ready to lose your life? Footnote 2. My editors want me to make it clear that I'm not threatening you. It's a play on the title, the first of many. Buckle up. Let's begin. Chapter 1. The Selfish Giant. In one degree or another, we all struggle with selfishness. Since it is so common, why worry about selfishness anyway? Because selfishness is really self-destruction in slow motion. Neil A. Maxwell, author. I was born with a frighteningly large head. Seriously, it scared the nurse. Not long after my grand entrance, she measured my head and whispered, "No, that can't be right." She measured it again. "It's not possible." She measured it a third time, then looked up at the doctor. "Do you realize that this boy has the biggest head I have ever measured?" Footnote 3. In the background, my poor mother, who gave birth to me without any sort of painkillers, deliriously shouted, "Tell me about it." It was a symbol of things to come. From ill-conceived notions in my 6-year-old brain about my ability to create and control a bonfire behind my house, to fanciful ideas that made me think I could befriend particularly aggressive wildlife, my big, egotistical head was always getting me into disastrous trouble. Footnote 4. I tried to feed a bull moose some apples. Incidentally, I once believed that moose were gentle giants. They are not. They are lawless animals. Yes, my giant head was always getting me into trouble, but luckily my family was always there to bail me out. I think my father realized that if he didn't do something beyond the usual punishments, then his son's self-centered ideas could very well lead to self-destruction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.